First of all, I want to thank the organizers for their kind invitation to this nice talk, nice conference. The title of the talk, as Rita said, is a generalization of severity inequality, but after some minutes I will add something in the title. Well, let me fix first some notations. I will work over an algebraically closed field of characteristic zero varieties, usually will be smooth, projective, and irregular. And moreover, of maximal Albanese dimension. I remind the definition that Rita and Margarita yesterday said. This means that if you have the Albanese map, then the dimension of X is the dimension of its image. Okay, let me add only an extra definition. If I have a map onto any abelian variety, I will say that X is of maximal A dimension, if it happens the same as in the case of the Albanese map. The dimension of X is the dimension of AX. Okay, so let's start talking about the classical severity inequality. First of all, I must say that there are a lot of results on the geometry of irregular varieties, and in the case of irregular surface, we can even say more. Most of the results we can obtain on irregular varieties, such as birationality of pluricanonical maps, Ithaca fibrations, and so on, are consequences of the application of the Fourier-Mukai transform, the generic vanishing theorems, and rheoretic techniques. The theorem I want to explain today is only consequences of two basic facts. One of them is Pardini's covering trick, which I will explain later, and the other is Clifford's lemma for canonical curves. And in fact, I want to add Clifford here, and the reason will be clear later. So I will call Clifford severity inequality. Okay, let me remind severity inequality. Let S be a smooth, complex, projective, minimal surface of maximal Albanese dimension, then we have this lower bound for the k square. Okay, this inequality that also appeared yesterday has a small history that I must remind. Let me set some remarks about this inequality, which is the classical one. First of all, it's sharp. Double covers of abelian surfaces verify the equality here. Okay. Second remark, bit of history. In the 30s, Severi stated this inequality, but the proof was wrong, as pointed out by Catanese in the 80s. And then Catanese stated this as a conjecture, Severi conjecture. In the, well, let's say, 2000, Manetti gives a proof, but with additional hypotheses, using, for example, that Ks is ample. And a complete, quick proof is given by Pardini, in 2004, and I will explain now. So, I will say some words about Pardini's proof. Okay.
He also proved that inequality holds. It's a double cover, which is.
Yes. In the case of ample, yes. In the case of K sample, equality holds, then it is a double cover of an abelian surface.
Double cover means non-singular.
Non-singular double cover, yes. Probably with some mild singularities. Okay. Okay.
Well, in the case ample.
Example.
Ah, okay, yes.
But of course, if it's not smooth, it has simple singularities, then of course it has a quality
state.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So. You have trouble with complicated singularities, in which case it would not satisfy this equals 4 chi.
You should have simple singularities.
Okay. Let me explain a bit the main points in Pardini's proof. Pardini's proof is based in two things. The first one is the classical slope inequality for fiber surfaces. So consider here a vibration of a smooth surface over a smooth curve. Let's call F the general fiber here, let B the genus of the base, and G the genus of the fiber. Then slope inequality, which is proved in different ways by several people like Shaw, Cornell van Harris, and also Moriwaki. Says this. This inequality here. Okay, it's easy to check that if the surface is of maximal Van Esse dimension, this factor here can be changed by 4. And so we have the following. And using that this using the definition of these two things, you obtain the following inequality. Which is written here. Okay, if we have a surface which is fibered over a curve of genus at least 1, this immediately implies severe inequality. Okay? But if you have a surface without irrational pencils, in this case, in the sense of genus of the base greater or equal than 1, then we cannot deduce from here a severe inequality. And then Pardini's proof uses the following argument. Which I call Pardini's covering trick. So consider here, we have the Albanese map. Now A is the Albanese map of S, and take any positive natural number. So and then in the Albanese variety of S, consider the multiplication by D. This is an etale map of the Brie D2Q, okay? And then consider here the base change, okay? Now, not necessarily this map is the Albanese map for S tilde, but this doesn't mind. And now consider the following. Take H, a very ample line bundle on the Albanese variety of S, and consider here A star of H, call it M, okay? And take here mu D upper star of H. By a classical result on the multiplication map of abelian varieties, this is linearly equivalent to H to this expression here, okay? And so numerically, this is like d squared h, and this is the basic fact in the proof. I will explain now, okay? Call this map here also mu, and so consider on S tilde, consider the following line bundles. On one side, just the pullback of the canonical line bundle of S, which is the canonical line bundle of S tilde, and then, which I call M tilde, the pullback of H. The pullback of H here in the Albanese variety of S. This pullback here is not exactly the pullback here of M, but it's a multiple of it. So the nice thing is that this is just this here. So the fact that this shift is divisible here by this square makes that I can construct here a line bundle which is divisible by d square, sorry, which divides d square times mu star of m. So now we can consider the following. First of all, observe that since this is an etale map of the grid d to 2q, this is d2q times kf square of s. The Euler characteristic of S is, this is an etale map, is d to the 2q times the Euler characteristics of S. But when I compute things relating the canonical shift of S tilde and M tilde, things does not are not multiplicative by this factor. We always must divide by d squared. I will show now. Okay, so consider now on S tilde, take two general elements of this line bundle M tilde, and then make the blow up here and consider this following vibration. Okay? If you consider this vibration, this is a vibration over P1, you can apply a slope inequality to this vibration. Okay? And if you apply a slope inequality, of course, I've made here a blow up, so some things may change, but basically what I have here is k square of s tilde minus 8 m tilde square. This is k square of x bar. Okay, this is greater or equal than 4 times the Euler characteristics of x bar, which is the same of x tilde, plus 4 times, sorry, in this case minus 4, because the genus of the base is 1, is, sorry, 0, is P1. Here the genus of M tilde minus 1. This is what slope inequality says. And now just observe how this depends on D. Here we have all the information. Okay, this is just T D to 2Q times K square of S. This is in the order of 2Q minus 4 times M square. This here is D to 2Q times chi of omega s, and this thing here, which is the genus of m tilde, we can compute it using the self-intersection of m tilde and m tilde with the canonical sheaf. The nice thing is that this is the order of d to q minus 2. Okay? And if we observe this inequality here, since this is true for any d, this is a polynomial in d, the leading coefficients here, which is k square, and this is 4 times chi omega s, we must verify, we must have this. Which is an inequality, okay? Yes, I wanted to explain with some detail this trick, because I will use exactly this construction, okay, in other situation. So let me observe the following. If we want to generalize a very inequality, the second part of Pardini's proof, Pardini's covering trick, is completely general. It's not necessary to work with a canonical sheaf, and this is not an argument of dimension 2. This is completely general in dimensions and for line bundles. The first part is only a result on fiber surfaces. So the first thing we must think is if we can extend or can find a slope inequality in other dimensions or for other line bundles. Okay? So first, let me say one word about the last remark prior to talk about slope inequalities. This is remark 3. Remark 4 is to look to the severe inequality from another point of view. Okay, take L to be a paracanonical line bundle. Take an alpha general in peak 0 and L kappa ks times alpha, then observe that L square is k square, and h0 of L is by generic vanishing since higher cohomologies vanish, this is exactly this. So in this case, with this Lie bundle L, Severn inequality reads in this way. Okay, L squared at least 4 times H0. As we will see, this is the right way to see Severn inequality to get a generalization, in the sense that it's an inequality involving the H0 of the Lie bundle, but not of the original Lie bundle, but the generic one in the parallel canonical system in this case. Okay, and we obtain this. Observe that in dimension 1, okay, sorry?
Clifford's theorem, we have a
tool. You have to in Clifford's theorem, okay? In Clifford's theorem, for example, in dimension 1, if you take L to be kc times alpha, then the degree of L is 2 times h0 of L. Okay, this is one version of Clifford's theorem on dimension 1. And in fact, if you take an L inside the canonical Lie bundle of a curve, you also have this. Sorry?
2h of L minus 2.
It's h, there's a project, I mean.
No, but it's the paracanonical.
I know. I
yes?
The generic one.
The generic one.
It says that below it's 2h0 minus 2, and then of course in this.
Yes, but if we take the general one, also is this inequality here, as we will see. So, okay, Clifford's theorem says exactly this for any Lie bundle living in the canonical sheaf, and so we can see Severn inequality as a particular instance of a generalization of Clifford's theorem to dimension 2. Okay, that's one of the reasons why I want to add Clifford to the title, to the name of the inequality. Okay? Okay, so.
Where does this inequality L squared greater than 4h now come from?
Sorry,
I just woke up. Where does L squared greater than 4h not L come from?
Severn inequality.
It's not Severn inequality.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Okay.
Sorry.
Yes.
I'm not completely so. First is L. What does it mean? L is smaller than KC. You mean the degree is smaller?
Yes. Yes. It's a.
Clifford should be special.
Yes. Yes.
So this is. Not effect. So you see, there is a discrepancy. Clifford is for special.
Yes.
Then you have these paracanonical which are not special, and then so.
Yes, but
way of unifying.
As I will see later in the main theorem, also this holds for any Lie bundle numerically less than the degree of L less or equal k or c.
Okay.
We will see this.
Okay.
It's not so clear.
The degree is smaller.
Yes, degree is smaller. Okay, but we will see. Okay, so let's talk about slope inequalities. Okay, so the general philosophy to study slope inequalities in higher dimension setting.
Sorry, it was stupid. I mean, if it's not special, there is an obvious inequality.
So yes, of course, in a Riemann rock. Assume you have a fibration of an n-dimensional variety over a curve, and you also call F here, the general fiber here. So, and to take a Lie bundle on X, usually an F Lie bundle. The philosophy of slope inequalities is to find a lower bound for the self-intersection of L depending on some numbers in the following sense. The lower bound lambda must be something depending on the fiber and the line bundle restricted to the fiber, and delta can be something, for example, in the following way: the degree of F star of L, or the degree of F here, or the characteristic Euler characteristics of L, etc. If you find something like this, you say that you have a slope inequality for a line bundle in respect with a fibration. In general, there are some cases where we can prove some inequalities of this type. The best inequality we can hope is the following, which I call strong slope inequality. And for a strong slope inequality, I mean this. This is the right generalization to any line bundle and any fibration of the classical slope inequality for fiber surfaces. So this is n, this is an n, yes. This strong slope inequality can be proven in some cases. For example, if the fiber is a curve and the line bundle is kx plus d, with the effective, this holds if the fiber is a non-hyperelliptic K3 surface. Also, if the fiber is some kind of scrolls, but I don't mind very much now. And the nice thing is that it's true in general if F is a curve, sorry, dimension one. The dimension of when the dimension of the fiber is one, but you take not the canonical sheaf, but something bigger, this inequality holds. Okay? And also if you take an hypersurface, and take L to be Kx. And this follows from some stability properties proven by John Nam Lee and Tian. When the fiber is an hypersurface, we can prove this for the canonical sheaf. Okay? Usually, this strong slope inequality follows from some stability conditions of the fiber. And this, in general, we don't have enough results on these stability conditions. So, in general, we can't prove this strong slope inequality. Okay? But there is another version of the slope inequality, which I call the weak slope inequality, which I will announce only for L equal to K. And X maximal Albanese dimension variety. And this weak slope inequality should be a consequence of the strong slope inequality, but we know it is true, for the canonical sheaf and for varieties of maximal Albanese dimensions, arguing by induction and with et al. Covers, we could prove this thing here. Okay. This weak slope inequality is not proven. This is not true. But
we means you and Lahotz, or
sorry?
We means you and Lahotz, or who?
No. I sorry. No, sorry. I. This cannot be proven in general because this we cannot have this inequality here. But observe that if you can prove this, which is a consequence of this, you can apply, for example, here Pardini's trick, in the same vein as here, and you would obtain an inequality for the self-intersection of the canonical sheaf for maximal Lebesgue dimension varieties, which is of the time 2n factorial chi. Okay? As we will see, this is in fact, if this were true, this is sharp because double covers of abelian varieties verify this inequality here. So this would imply severely higher dimensional severe inequality. Okay?
F is a morphism.
It's a fibration, connected fibers.
Yes, and I know what Kf is.
Yes.
It's a relative canonical.
Yes.
I don't know who Kf is.
Kf is chi ox minus chi omega b. This is, sorry.
It's minus the product.
This is the relative. This is, okay? Which is always positive. Okay. So let me talk about the continuous rank. The continuous rank. It's the following.
I finally understand why you write chi of omega instead of chi of omega.
Yes. Yes, this is supposed to, yes. Okay. In the case of surfaces, it's the same, but, okay.
Minus one
to the end. Yes. Okay, the continuous run. Let's consider X a variety of dimension n and a map to an abelian variety and assume that X is of maximal A dimension. Okay? So take L, a line bundle on X, and we define I define H I A L to be the minimum for alpha in A dual of H I of X L times A star of alpha. This minimum value here. Okay? So I consider the minimum value of the I cohomology group of L and all its algebraically equivalent line bundles coming from A. Okay? This, we could say this is the rank on the of this piece of the Fourier-Mukai transform of the line bundle L respect with the map A, but I don't use this notation here. In the case, sorry?
Alpha is in
peak 0
of A.
Alpha is of A, yes, in A dual.
Okay.
Yes, it's just in peak 0 of A. Okay, sorry. In the case of H0 of A, I will say this is the continuous rank. And this is mainly the good definitions for extending severe inequality to higher dimensions and to other line bundles. Let me make some examples. Okay, the first one, assume that L is a GB sheaf, so a generic vanishing sheaf. This means that higher cohomology vanishes generically with respect to any map of maximal A dimension. For example, this happens if L is kx plus d and d is nef. Okay? Then in this case, this number is just the Euler characteristics. Okay?
alpha in pick zero of x?
Because I need...
A is the dual of pick zero of x. Because it's the dual of the dual of the dual.
But this is a subspace of pick
This is...
It's a sub-variety.
This is not the Albanese map. This is not the Albanese map.
Then it just means for a given sub-variety of the...
Yes, for a given sub-variety. That's why I put here the name of the map. Because in the proof, in fact, even if we start with the Albanese map of one variety, in the proof we can change and the new maps are not the Albanese maps. Okay? Okay. Secondly, if we have L kx plus d with the big N F, this number is just H0. Okay? Because higher cohomology vanishes not only for the algebraic general element, but also for the same metal. So let me... Okay. Now, assume you have a vibration here, as there, and you consider the relative canonical sheath. And I keep the notation that x is of maximal A dimension, so in particular of maximal Albanese dimension, then this number here is at least, let me put B at least 1, this number is at least this here, which is not exactly this one. There is a factor of 2 here, but it's very close to this number here. But we don't know if equality holds. In fact, if I want to put an equality, I should put here this number here. Okay. Let me make some remarks. The first one is that if I have a diagram as in Pardini's proof, if I have a diagram like this, okay, and I take an element in peak S, then the H0A of L, sorry, the H0A tilde of L tilde, where L tilde is the pullback of L to X tilde, then this number is multiplicative. Okay? Yes, that happens in Pardini's proof with the Euler characteristics. Okay? And second remark here, let me state with this language which says a very inequality. Okay, since Ks is a generic vanishing sheaf, H0 of Ks is just the Euler characteristics, and so severe inequality reads in this way with this new notation. Okay? Okay, so let's talk about the main theorem. So, sorry. better.
Maximal
Lanesse dimension and minimal the surface, and hence KSNF, which is what I use. Well, as we will see, the important thing here is that the line bundle is NF. Okay. So let's state the main theorem. It ends at least 4, we must put an extra assumption, but this is a work in progress. I believe this is not necessary, it's only a technical point that indeed at this moment I must put, but for dimension 2 and 3 we don't need any hypothesis. Take an F line bundle on X, then first, we have this. Okay, for any L, we have this inequality here. And if L numerically is less or equal than a multiple of the canonical sheaf, okay, it could be a rational multiple, then no, here n factorial. Here n factorial. This happens. Okay. So, I will spend several cases, and I will see this as a generalization of the classical Severin inequality for the canonical sheaf. But in general, let me say some remarks and examples to explain the statement. If you take X to be an abelian variety and L an ample line bundle on the abelian variety, then equality holds in 1. So 1 in general is sharp. Okay? Secondly, Asymptotic Riemann rock says that for a multiple of an Ampeline bundle, asymptotically we have this inequality. If you take a multiple of an Ampeline bundle, on a general type variety, asymptotic Riemann-Roch says also that in the limit we have this inequality in 1. So in general, this is asymptotically sharp. Let's see 2. Okay, if we consider L Kx and we assume it is Neff, okay. In the case of surfaces, this is set. This is to say that S is minimal. Okay, inequality 2 says exactly this. Which is the generalization of Severin inequality for the canonical sheaf I mentioned before. And this inequality is sharp because you have the double covers of abelian varieties which verify this equality. In general, if X is of general type, then omega X is big, and so always exists an error such that H0 of RKX minus L is not zero. It's effective, so always we can find an R in this situation. Okay? So in a general type variety, we can always apply part 2 if we can find an R with this relation here. If the variety is not of general type, obviously we have the case of abelian variety, we cannot apply part 2. Okay? 4, if L is Kx plus D, we have the following Ln.
Means that on movable curves is positive.
Yes, in a movable intersection with is numerically yes, intersection with ample divisor is positive. This is only what really need. Okay. We have this. If D is Neff, since when D is Neff, we have generic vanishing. Then we have this, okay, and this, if D is bigger than F, we have this. Okay? Since we computed this in the case of F and bigger than F, okay? Sorry?
R is
the, this number here. Ah, oh, sorry, yes, yes. You need the L is more than Kx. Sorry, yes, same in the theorem, okay? 5, assume you have a vibration F with B at least 1, okay? Sorry, you have a relatively minimal vibration. Okay, so then the relative canonical shape is nef, and you can prove this. In this case, the relative canonical shape lives inside the canonical shape, so we can take r equal to 1. When r is equal to 1, this is 2. I forgot here n factorial. So we have here 2 n factorial. And now, in the case of a vibration, I compute this number. I can compute this number here, and we don't have here, but at least this number was this quantity here. And in fact, I can include this factor here. So this particular case of this generalization of Sever inequality is a weak slope inequality, a weak slope type inequality. Okay. More examples. In the case of surfaces, we can use the theorem to study some line bundles related with the canonical sheaf. I only put one example. Assume, for example, that the canonical sheaf is decomposable as L1 plus S2, and both are nef. In this case, if you apply the theorem both for L1 and L2 and compute, you obtain the following. We obtain this, which is, if you know how to compute H1 of L1 with respect to A, this is a stronger inequality than Sever inequality. For example, if you can prove that this is at least Q minus 3, you will obtain the Manetti-Reed inequality that Margarita mentioned yesterday. Okay? If this were true, you can find a decomposition with this property, you obtain Manetti-Reed inequality. Observe that, for example, if you have S a product of curves, this is an equality. This is exactly 8 g1 minus 1, g2 minus 1, and this is equal to 4 times g1 minus 1, g2 minus 1, plus 4 times, you can compute this, and it's g1 minus 1, g2 minus 1. Okay? In the case of a product, this inequality here, for example, is an equality. Okay, and let me say only one word. Well, let me explain the proof better. Sorry. Idea of proof of the theorem. Okay? The idea is to substitute the slope inequality in Pardini's proof by another inequality that can be used in this Pardini's covering trick. This other inequality, which I will write now, is only a consequence of Clifford's theorem. It's by an induction process. The case n equal to 1 is the Clifford's theorem, and the rest is just applying Shaw's method and uses induction. Okay? So the step 1 Let me be a bit sloppy. So let M be I will use this construction. So let M be the pullback of a very ample line bundle of the Erlangs on the variety A, and assume all the hypotheses of the main theorem. Then the following inequality holds. I will write in this way. I will write it only in the case 2 of the theorem. Case the theorem has two cases. In the first case, this factor is 1. Let me write in this way, only in the case 2 of the theorem. Okay? This proposition also would have two parts, but let me write this, where sigma I are something depending on x, l, and m, but are bounded. And C is a constant. Okay?
I don't understand. They're bounded in terms of what?
Bounded by a constant independently on X, L, and M. Okay? Independently. Bounded independently on all this. The expression is complicated. For example, this sigma zero is it. Okay. Sigma zero is this, which is bounded. Okay. So the proof of this proposition, let me write only the case n equal to 1. The case n equal to 1 is, for example, if R is bigger than 1, this is Riemann-Roch. We can write this as Riemann-Roch, but the case less or equal than 1, just let me say that this is degree of L plus 2 greater or equal than 2 times H0 of XL. This is Clifford's. Okay? This expression here is just the first part. The constant is 0. We have a constant here, and then we have exactly Clifford's lemma. Okay? The case n equal to 1 has these expressions here. For n bigger, we must apply with some care Schell's method. Schell's method is a method which allows to study fibrations, studying linear systems on the fibers, and this allows to bound things and knowing things on the fibers, and this is the induction process I apply to obtain this statement in general. Okay? So this is the inequality that substitutes to slope inequality. Okay? So now let's see this inequality looking also to Pardini's construction, Pardini's covering trick. So consider our variety here. Now this is x, we have this construction, now we don't have the canonical sheaf, we have the line bundle L, we have all this construction, and I apply to this step here, this proposition. If I look to the order of growing on all the quantities, okay, this L in this case would be L tilde. This quantity here is its order of growing is d to the 2q, and the other terms are lower terms. And this here is greater or equal than h0a of xl, because this quantity was the minimum, and this is multiplicative by a tall covers, and this is of the order of t to the 2q. Okay, and the rest of the terms here have lower order, and so in the limit we have the theorem. Okay, it's exactly the same. Just in the last minute, just let me say one word in the case of non-maximal Banach dimension. If we have non-maximal Albanese dimension, the theorem obviously is false. Okay, we can have here our map, and then this is surjective to something which has dimension less, strictly less than the dimension of x. And you easily can construct a counterexample to the theorem. But it seems, and this is a work in progress, that if you take L, which is transversal to the fibers of the Albanese map, something can be said. Probably the inequality is not the same, but something can be said. In this is a particularly interesting case, because you can consider the following situation. Take a maximal Albanese dimension variety and take a vector bundle.
So you mean this map with fiber and big or something?
No, I mean that not on the fibers, but also that is transversal to the fibers, so you... Yes, it's big on the fibers, yes. Okay, big on the fibers. So, for example, I'll consider a maximal Banach dimension variety, I consider a vector bundle of dimension m, and now consider the projectivization of this vector bundle. Okay? You can consider the Banach map of x, which of course factorizes through the Albanese map of Z. You have this situation here. And in this situation, of course, X is not of maximal Albanese dimension, but you have here a natural line bundle which is transversal to the fibers of the Albanese, which is OOX1. Okay. If some inequality works in the case of non-maximal Albanese dimension, then we could obtain some lower bound for this, depending on h0a of e, which of course is the same of h0a, sorry, this would be of L, which of course is the same that this. If we can find a lower bound of this, we could extend this very inequality not only to NF line bundles, but also to NF vector bundles. But this is still a work in progress. Okay, that's all. Thank you.